What to say?
Good morning. Good way to start the day. The strange thing is, on Monday, there was only like four people here too. So I think my class has now all the cases. All the cases. We have other people to start showing up. I guess Monday we had to start. All right, so just write something down in your notes for me. I had the other class turn them in, but then it became silly because there was only like four of us here, and I was like, let's just write down your answers and we'll talk about them. Two strange questions for you, which should be nothing new. The first one would be, if you could decide, how long would you like to live? I know it's a deep question for almost 9 o'clock on a Wednesday morning. But if you could pick, I'm not sure if you've watched any of the content yet that's up there, but transhumanism, what the hell? Anyone know what that means? It sounds like science fiction because it has been. Transhumanism is the idea that we could take Dante and put him inside a machine. I mean, you're your brain, right? When you're still Dante, you don't have your left arm or your right arm or your left leg, but your brain is you. What if we could figure out a way to put that in something and keep you alive? It's called transhumanism. You might be surprised how far people have come. Anyway, but there's other things too. So, what'd you guys write down? Anyone want to live forever, by the way? Why would you say no? No one wants to die, so why don't you want to live forever? Yeah.
Good one.
But what if, what do you mean by that?
Obviously, you don't
want
to keep living on if, like, things are bad, like, your health is deteriorating.
Now, that's true, but what if I could pause your aging so that you're, like, your 40-year-old self for 300 more years? Yeah.
I think it's
the way
how precious time is. So,
like, time. No one said that on Monday, but I like that take. It's almost like if you go to Disneyland every week,
yeah.
Doesn't it kind of cease to be fun? Because it's supposed to be something special. Like, my little 9-year-old came up with that one this Christmas. She's like, I wish every day was Christmas. I'm like, no, you don't. She's like, you're right. Because then it wouldn't be fun. Like, opening all those open more presents. Yay. Anybody else?
I just said I'd like to live as long as I could. Do everything that I wanted to do.
And then you'll be ready to go.
Yeah.
It's a weird question to think about. Again, if you haven't dove into some of this stuff yet, well, I'll fill in some blanks before you go. Second question, much different. Has nothing to do with death or even living longer at all. I feel like at least one of you in this class has maybe heard this story before. So just maybe play dumb or write down the same answer that you did maybe last semester or two semesters ago. Think of yourself maybe the month before you came to Mount Union. So you just graduated high school, whatever it is you're doing. Let's pretend you're sitting in your room, minding your own business, and there's a little knock at the door.
Dante!
Oh, stop thinking about Dante. You're sitting right here. So a little knock at your door, and it's your parents and or legal guardian, whoever it is that's taking care of you. And they say, well, you're so excited. You're going to Mount Union. This is a new chapter in your life. You're having, oh, it's just, you're just, you're buying purple things. You can't wait to become a Raider. But they have a proposal for you. And it's actually written down on a piece of paper. And the proposal goes like this. If you decide to major in business, to choose a business major, and specialize in accounting, and you keep at least a C average with all of your classes, mom and dad will pay for everything. You'll never have any student loan debt. And to make it even sweeter, you won't even have to like buy anything. Like, let's say you go to McDonald's on a Saturday. Just give us the receipt. We'll reimburse you. if you go to a keg party on Thursday, why are you going to a keg party on Thursday? But if you, well, in other words, well, how many of you have a part-time job? Like even something tight. I always have at least three or four. But, right, imagine how much money you could save, even with a little part-time job, if you never paid for any, and I mean anything, any bill. So in other words, no money leaves you, you just collect money in any way that you want to, but you have to major in business and you have to specialize in accounting. Make the pot even sweeter, there's a job waiting for you when you graduate in accounting, because you specialize in it, and now you're an accountant. If you pull the plug, though, it's all on you. So if you sign this contract, you're agreeing to this. And if you ever renege on it, word out. And you're stuck with everything. Would you sign the contract? I know. Where the hell did you come up with this one? What do you think? I guess you don't really need to write it down. Well, maybe because we're not coming to it yet. So actually, write an answer down. I'll give you 30 seconds. You have to sign quick. This contract will self-destruct. 30 seconds. This question, by the way, is based on a true story. It's not me. But it is based on a true story. I mean, how could you make something like that? I'd like to think I'm creative, but I wouldn't come up with that. What did you sign about? I mean, I guess if you can't think of an answer, we'll both be coming back to it anyway. So if you haven't looked at this quite yet, we are ending chapter 2, bio, psycho, social models of human development. Before we launch off into maybe some things you might find a little bit more interesting. So I guess this is the last week where we're like laying groundwork and ideas and glossary of terms and perspectives and all that stuff. Next week, we'll actually start talking about, I think the first place we'll go is the physical body. Like how does, what changes happen? Seems like a natural place to start. Because that's when you think of getting older, you think of, who has to live for 300 years if it just keeps getting worse? Like, Jesus, 90 was bad, just wait till 302. So chapter 2 is still where we're at. After today, I'm going to make a little online lecture. So the online stuff, I didn't know exactly where we were going to stop Monday, but now, obviously, I know. So it's not going to be like an hour long or anything like that. But I'll have an online lecture to supplement the stuff that's online for you. I know that looks, if you haven't clicked on them, it looks like a long list of like online, how long am I going to spend watching these videos? They're all relatively brief. So it's not like they're each like 50-minute documentaries up there. They're like 5 minutes, 6 minutes. Oh, and then, yes, the interview project. I'll come to that before you go. We're starting that this week. I already have one response, which is nice. That was surprising. Someone on Monday already did it and had a really good experience. So the interview project this week, and that'll take care of the discussion forum. And with that little lecture, I'll also, someone asked me, am I ever going to find out how I did on the quiz? Well, you know how you did on the quiz, but what did I miss? That sort of thing. For obvious reasons, I don't have the answers pop up after you take the quiz, since it's out there. But I always do a quiz review, and since I'm going to do a little mini lecture, I'll have the quiz review kind of built into that. So keep an eye out for that. I'll probably send an email when it pops up. All right, so that's that. Here's where we start. We're not going to spend much time at all with Freud, but just a little bit. You already watched a little video that gave you a primer on him. And there was a question on the quiz about him. It was supposed to be kind of like a softball. As long as you watched, hopefully you got it. Oh, there we go. So Sigmund Freud and Erik Erikson. Erikson is where we're going to kind of hover for most of the time because he still has a much bigger and meaningful impact on human development. But there is a couple things I just wanted to make sure you have taken away from Freud. First, I think I mentioned this, it's a psychodynamic theory. So one thing that we probably all agree that was a Freudian idea is that the past is important for the present. That's the first thing to know. Most people, I rarely meet a person who say the past is irrelevant. In fact, I don't know if I've ever met anyone who thinks the past is just irrelevant. But that was kind of a Freudian idea, that in terms of your development, the way your parents treated you, raised you, the interactions you had with your friends, your environment, all of that pushes your development and has some kind of impact on you. Which is why when he did his therapy, he did spend most of the time talking about the past. That was his idea. Does it have relevance? Of course it does. The next thing is, I just want to jump down to the end. And it has something to do with the question that was on your quiz. Where does his theory of development end? In other words, when are you done, according to Freud? At puberty, exactly. So I'll give him some credit. I mean, he was the first person to actually make a theory of human development. But I don't think most people would agree that your development stops at puberty. But according to Freud, that's it. That's his stages literally take you up from birth to about age 13, and then you're just off into the world. So we're all adult 13-year-olds walking around the earth. And that left a legacy. And the legacy that left is, unfortunately, a lot of people sort of ignore anything like past the age of 21 or so. In other words, it's like you become adults, and then we just kind of go off, and nothing ever changes. Nothing ever develops. There's really no more roadblocks. I mean, sure, things happen to you. You get married, you buy a house, you get a job, all that sort of stuff. But in terms of development, we usually think of adulthood done, because you're an adult. Now you're just dying, right? You came up the hill, now you're falling down it slowly. So that was his legacy, and that kind of left an imprint on lots of people's ideas about development until, well, we'll come to him, until his student, Erik Erikson, kind of changed things. But before we get to Erikson, anyone know who this is? Some of you do, I think, because he had popped up in a class. So if you're one of those people that took a class with me where, for some reason, I use him in different classes for different reasons. Dante, what class was it?
Used for Erik's family.
Oh,
so
yes.
So abnormal.
Yes, that makes sense. Anybody? No? Not at all. Let me give you his name. Jason Becker. Does that ring a bell? I guess I'm talking to everyone except for Dante. He knows the answer. Nothing? All right, so for those of you drawing a blank, like anxiously waiting for me to get done with this, what about the name Van Halen? Does that ring a bell? You said yes right away. What do you think of when you think of Van Halen?
Guitar player.
Exactly. I know he passed away recently, but okay, so you don't know who Jason Becker is, which is fine. And Van Halen, just because you know who he is doesn't mean like you like his music, that sort of thing. But a neuron got ignited in your brain, like, oh, Van Halen, that sounds familiar. Why does that sound familiar? Oh yeah, famous like rock musician, okay. Well, if what happened to Jason Becker didn't happen to Jason Becker, the same part of your brain that lit up when I said the words Van Halen would be lighting up right now. You'd be like, oh yeah, Jason, everyone would know who Jason Becker is. Doesn't mean you'd like his music. I mean, obviously, he plays guitar. He's still alive, by the way. But a very unfortunate thing happened to him. And because of that, no one knows who he is, which is really, really, really unfortunate, because there was a time when he was considered perhaps the best guitar player on planet Earth. And not just, hey, I'm going to make some rock music, but literally like classical, rock, anything. He was considered the world's best guitarist, hands down. And everybody wanted to sign him. Everyone wanted him to be in his band. And then when he was 19, something happened to him, which changed the course of his life forever. I said, he's not dead.
L-A-D, ladies, A-M-G-E, gentlemen, T-H-I, this is Jason Becker, T-H-E, the S-E-X, sexiest, M-A, man, alive.
There's nobody better than that dude. He was on another level. When people would hear him, they'd turn their head and go, what the heck was that? But he wouldn't just play a bar piece. He could set a guitar on his lap and play it that way. Jason was on his way to becoming a really big rock star. He was going to just take over the world. And that's when Jason told us his leg was kind of bothering him.
He just had been limping for a while, and we finally talked him into getting it checked out at Kaiser in LA when he was there, and that's when all the trouble started.
We believe you've got Lou Gehrig's disease and you have 3 to 5 years to live. I think his answer was, am I going to be able to tour? Eventually, he needed crutches, then a wheelchair. Then it just got to where, you know, he'd drop the guitar and couldn't even hang on to it.
But he was really sick. He was really thin and really pale. He was a different person.
It never surprised me that if there was a way to keep making music, he would.
His mindset was, well, you know, I just have to go do it. And so we created a system to allow Jason to be able, using just his chin, sort of one click at a time, to be able to enter in the notes.
God, he just kept working. Happened so young, and he just still had a life to live, and he wanted to live it. That's when I invented the sign language for him. Basically, it's an eye geometry. Every letter of the alphabet has two eye movements.
I remember I came to his house, and he played this thing for me, and I went, how did you do this? I was just floored.
Why he's still here. But he's still here.
Somewhere along the line, they changed the name. If you like documentaries, I'm kind of a documentary nerd. You could make a documentary about carpet production, and if it was well done, I would like it. But the documentary is called Not Dead Yet. If you like documentaries, it's really good, and you can find it. It's floating around YouTube and Netflix and all that stuff, but so, this guy's 19 years old, so he's just like you. I don't know what your dream is, but imagine if your dream literally came true. Like, you knew exactly what you wanted to do. Of course, he wanted to be, I mean, who wouldn't want to be? In the 80s and the 90s, who wouldn't want to be a rock star and tour with Eddie Van Halen and David Lee Roth? And that's exactly what was happening to him. He had literally just signed the contract to tour with David Lee Roth, who was the lead singer for Van Halen at one point. Dream come true. He's in his band. That's it. And they're going to go on tour. And right when he does this, this happens to him. And he gets told, sorry. And the very thing that is who he is taken away from him slowly. Not sure if you know anyone who's had ALS. My neighbor growing up had it. We watched him over a period of about 3 years. He went from being a baseball coach to being in a wheelchair to being in a hospital bed. And then he was gone. That's what it does. Slowly just kills you. You lose all muscle activity. Even his chin, the little thing they made for him, he lost that too. It only lasted for about 3 months, and then he lost that. So all he has to move is his eyeballs. That's it. And he just wrote an album. It took him 3.5 years to make it. It got nominated for like 5 Grammy Awards. But he made this thing with his eyeballs. I guess the question I always toss out to people is, would you have, like, I don't know, what do we call it? The resilience to keep going? Or would you just want to give up? Or would you be able to find, like, the wherewithal to do this? And how in the hell did he do it? Like, how did he, of course it was difficult, but how did he find, like, the inner stuff, like, to keep going? And it's a question that's always on my mind. And the best answer I've come up with, the best answer I can come up with lies in this. So, something called Psychosocial Theory by Eric Erickson. I know you watched a little video on it, but we're going to dig a little bit deeper into it. Don't write any of this down. I'll explain it if it makes no sense to you. But hopefully, if you did watch that video last week, I'll fill in any blanks and maybe describe it in a slightly different way. You know you're a nerd when you have a favorite theory of psychological development. This happens to me a lot. I don't have like a poster in my room or anything. But and the reason I like it is it's still relevant. Like it's 2021, and I have a hard time envisioning when this will become irrelevant. So Erikson wrote a theory of human development called a psychosocial theory. And right off the bat, the first thing I want you to write down is what makes it different is it was the first, not really the last, but it's still the first and still today the most influential theory of development that takes you from birth all the way to death. So it doesn't skip any steps. It doesn't stop at puberty. It goes into your 40s and your 50s and your 80s and your 90s. So it doesn't stop. It was the first theory to do this, and people thought, wow, we still go through things when we're 50? Huh. And it really made people think that human development doesn't stop when you're an adult. And it's the reason classes like this exist today, by the way. Aging in adulthood? What is there to know? Aren't you just dying? You want to disengage from society? Become depressed and isolated? No, not at all. And this theory kind of opened the eyes to people to really at least consider maybe stuff does happen after the age of 18 and 21. All right, so first, kind of a glossary of terms here. Some of which should sound familiar, assuming you watched that video. The first you can see, so pay no attention to the left side. That's just pointing out Freud's theory and how it kind of compares. There's 8 stages of development, according to Erik Erikson. And each of these are what he called an emotional crisis. Doesn't that sound like fun? So life is nothing but a cascade of emotional crises that you need to solve. Maybe not as bad as it sounds, but that's what they are. You can see the highlights here. They're all something versus something else. In other words, at each of these stages, and by the way, you're right here, and this is where that question will come in. You're right here, and this is where we're going to focus on our class, 5, 6, 7, and 8. If you're interested in this, go take the child development class. But 5, 6, 7, and 8 is where we're at. And you're in something called identity versus role confusion. We'll zoom in on that later. If you solve it positively, great. You'll have something that we'll call an identity. We'll define that in a little bit. But if you don't, it sounds like you're going to end up confused for the rest of your life. Well, there's a name for this. This is our second little term. Good outcome? Awesome. Keep going. But if you have a bad outcome at one of these crises, you're going to still go. It's not like you're going to stop developing. But you're going to carry something with you. Have you ever heard the term emotional baggage? You don't want to date him because he has emotional baggage. That's now you know where that came from. Erikson. He called it a core pathology. Erikson came up with this idea that if bad, negative things happen to you in the past, they don't go away. You carry them with you on your journey. Today we call it emotional baggage. That's how you get to fight if you want. Erikson called it a core pathology. I always use the first one as an example because it's pretty easy. When you think of an infant, that's where you're at with trust versus mistrust. And what kind of emotional crisis is a six-month-old going through, right? Well, hang around a six-month-old. They appear to be going through a lot of emotional crises. But if you think about how this works, trust versus mistrust, right? You're solely dependent on the people around you. You can't get up and go to the fridge and get yourself a snack. So if you cry and people come, you cry and people come, you need stuff and people come, something happens, people take care of you. Well, that's going to build in you a sense of trust of the world around you. But what if you cry and no one comes? What if you cry and they come like 30% of the time? 70% of the time the mom's on Facebook ignoring everything. You cry. So then you start to build a sense of mistrust. You never know, are they going to come or not? Well, Erikson would call that a core pathology that you would take with you. Any questions along the way, you just let me know. How did he pick these? People always wonder, like, what? I mean, most people agree that it makes intuitive sense that a baby would be dealing with maybe trust or mistrust. That makes sense. But why the others? Why did he pick the themes? I always think of them more as themes than emotional crises. Well, here's this word again. I shortened it. I called it BPS. Erickson didn't just, like, pull these out of the hat. Like, well, let's see. Adulthood. Oh, generativity versus stagnation. Let's put it there. Now, the reason he chose these is because he argued these are biopsychosocial critical periods in your life. Biopsychosocial critical periods. What the heck does that mean? Well, what does that mean? No ideas? Let me tell you what he meant by that. Think of bio, psycho, and social as being stars, and they're going to align. In other words, the stars are aligning biologically, psychologically, and socially for this to be the most important issue in your life to resolve. A lot of people see this theory and they think he meant that's the only thing. No, this isn't. He doesn't mean it's the only thing going on for you. We always have 10, 11 things going on. But his point was, due to your biology, how mature you are biologically, how mature you are psychologically, and what society is telling you to do, remember those normative influences we talked about? This is currently the big thing that you need to figure out. And this takes us all the way back to the beginning when I said this theory is still relevant. Here you are. Why are you here about union? Remember when you were a freshman and everyone asked you questions like that? Let's talk about why you're here. What do you want to do on this journey? People talk like that when you come to college, right? Being completely honest, why are you here? I mean, not here, but here. Why are you in college? You didn't have to. Remember Glenn? Glenn waited until he was 40. Anybody, help me out here.
That's what everyone else did in my family.
What's that?
That's what everyone else did.
Well, at least you're honest, so everyone else went. Why not? Like, what would you like? What do you want to happen when you're done?
Yeah, school.
Well, there we go. So now you see where I'm going with this. Exactly. Some people even talk like this. You'll say, why are you here? I'm here to find myself. And they walk around. I hope they do. They see a mirror. Oh, there I am. But anyway. So, right, no, let's zoom in, actually. Let's zoom in on our first stage. 5, 6, 7. So we're going to start with identity versus role confusion. This is where you're at. It's 2021, and his theory is still correct. I would argue, yes, you guys got a lot of stuff going on, like we all do. But I would agree with him that currently, maybe one of the most important things for you to figure out is, one, what would you like to do with the rest of your life? Because that's what he meant by identity. So identity actually means two things. The first is literally, what's your purpose? For some people, it takes a long time to figure this out, and that's okay. But what would you like to do? What were you chosen to do, or what's the point? Admittingly, it took me a long time. I was the kid walking around Ohio State's campus, watching all of my friends figure it out, wondering, when is the light bulb going to go off? It's a long, uninteresting story, but it took well into my young 20s, actually, before the light bulb finally went off. But anyway, if you're curious, I'll tell it to you, put you to sleep. The other thing that identity means, though, is what do you truly believe and value in life? So it's more than just your job and your career. It's also, who are you as a person? What do you believe and what do you value? And he's talking about things like faith, religion, morals. I mean, we could go on and on. I don't want to really make this too exacerbatingly long. But so two main things. What do you want to do with the rest of your life? And what do you value? What do you believe? I would agree with him. That seems like that's part of who a person actually is. Some people believe things and they have no idea. They never even pause to think why they believe them. Like, I don't know. I've always believed that. Well, why? Maybe it's time for you to make up your own mind, because there's like a million choices out there. So identity, and of course the core pathology, would be role confusion. Well, to make this even a little bit more interesting, I always like on the live feeds, okay, it's just like a static camera, so I spend like 80% of the time completely out of frame. So I apologize. If you're sitting out there wondering, gosh, Dr. Meyer, I don't know if I have an identity. How many different identity types are there? I know that question's on the top of your head, so I'm here to share it with you. We actually know. It turns out there's 4 different identity styles that young people like yourself and slightly older people like myself carry with us. And those 4 identity styles are created by 2 different behaviors that you're supposed to be doing. Exploration, which is why the EXP is there, and then also commitment. Think of values and beliefs, right? Let's say you call yourself a Methodist. I just picked that out of left field in my brain. Okay, well, are you a Methodist because you got taken to the church since you were 2 and you're just sort of blindly following along? And that you're committed to it, apparently, because you called yourself that. Or have you explored other ideas that are out there? Have you ever picked up a book on, let's get radical, Lutheranism? Or Buddhism? Have you explored other religions to see what else is out there before you've committed to this? Because that's quite a commitment you're making. So that's kind of the road that we're going down here. So exploration and commitment. Let's walk through these 4 identity styles. The first one, and none of these, by the way, we're putting value judgments on as good or bad. They just are what they are based on what you're choosing to do. I had a roommate. I have lots of roommates. I like telling stories about my former roommates, but one of my favorites was a guy named Jim. And Jim, every time I talk about a diffuse identity style, I think of him. Picture North American Jesus, like our image of what Jesus was supposed to look, right? The long hair, kind of like a goatee-ish beard, always wearing robes. Of course, Jim wore a bathrobe. That was Jim, kind of long, really tall guy, really quiet, really soft-spoken, really gentle, kind. For all I know, he was Jesus. But anyway, that's Jim. But he was also the epitome of a diffuse identity style. What is this? Because, you know, in terms of exploration and commitment, what was Jim doing? I feel like some of you have heard this before. It depends on the classes you've taken. He wasn't doing either. So diffuse means you're not exploring and you're not committed to anything. Jim was really, really, really smart, really kind, really nice, fun guy to be around. In fact, he was the first person I ever met who had above a 4.0. I didn't even know that was possible, where like the country that I came from, it wasn't possible. But he was really smart. He had a full ride to Ohio State University, computer engineering, back in the 90s. Like, who knows? But he wasn't interested like in classes, so he never really went to classes. I mean, he went to the ones that he had to go through. So he never really explored, like, picking a major. He was undecided. In fact, end of the story, he actually graduated at Ohio State undecided. You can actually do that. I'm not sure if they, but when I was there, you could, I know, you, if you didn't pick, they still let you stick around. And he got like a general degree. It just said like general, congratulations, you graduated, never made it from home. So he never committed really to a major. He never really committed to like a job type thing. He just stayed in his room and smoked weed and played video games the entire time. Like literally, like that's all Jim. We didn't see him a lot. And the fun, when he would emerge, you'd always wonder, like, ooh, what's he going to say? He's going to say something, like Forrest Gump. So diffuse, that's our diffuse identity style. The second one, how many of you would sign the contract? Why? There's no right or wrong answer.
Lucky for me, I was that.
Right?
So, like, that wouldn't be a bad idea for me?
No. I always preface this with, you know, the fun thing is, if this is part of your dream, this is like a dream come true. Like, hooray! Since the age of three, accountants. It's like, not that you talk like that at all. To me, every accountant does. So if you really wanted to be an accountant, this is you just hit the jackpot. Anybody else, though? You're the only one to raise your hand. I mean, you might be the only one who wants to participate. Yeah.
I would say yeah, because I didn't
really
know what I wanted to do.
I had a girl in the other section who said that too. She's undecided, so maybe they just picked for me. Okay. Anybody else? Anyone not signed the contract? You're saying no. Why not?
Because I hate
math. He's the exact opposite. Well, like I told you, I'm just curious. Just to plant this in your head. Out of curiosity, since you said you'd sign it because you were undecided, what if you turned out you hate it? Now you're kind of stuck, aren't you?
Yeah.
Because remember what they told you? If you pull out, you're on your own. Would you stick with it? Like, what if you took, like, 2 years of business and you're just like, oh my God, I do not want to do this for the rest of my life. So I always tell people, if you don't like your classes, you're going to hate your job. Because the classes you're taking are a representation of your future job. I know. You stop, right? Well, this happened to a guy named Jeff. Jeff was another roommate of mine. This actually happened to this kid. So we were freshmen at The Ohio State University, and he actually lived across the hall from me. And we were just hanging out. We had been at college, I don't know, maybe a month or so. Just hanging out one night, and kind of glanced. I was in his room and I saw something. I just looked at it because he had it taped to his wall. And I read it and I'm like, what the? Like, is this real? This can't be real because it was like a contract. And it said, like, he had to fill Jeff, like, fill in his name. His dad was kind of a big wig accountant in Columbus, Ohio. But his dad had literally made a contract and there's his parents' name and there's his little signature at the bottom. And of course, before I tell Jeff, I'm like telling everyone else, like, and we look at this thing and we're taking pictures with cameras used to look like this. They were boxes. We're taking pictures. So just to prove that we found this thing, and of course he walks in, he's like, oh my God, like I can't believe. So we're talking to him like, is this real? And at first we were like, damn it. That's freaking awesome. Like you have no bills at all. Like no wonder. We had one, like he always seemed to have my money. Like where's Jeff? Like, whatever. Never. It's like, oh, sure, I'll buy that. Well, of course he's going to buy it because he's going to get reimbursed for it in 2 weeks. So it sounded great until I would say like midway spring, like in the spring of our first year. And you could see the change start to happen because he hated it. He could do it. He could hack it. But he hated all of his classes. And Jeff became the guy that you like to be around on Saturday and Sunday. But during the week, he was just the most miserable, hate-filled ball of depression. It was so, and we tried. We tried so hard to talk him out of it, like just stop. Like, you're this is not good. Like, because we liked Jeff. He was our friend. But he stuck with it. And he got a job, and he became an accountant. And to this day, he's the only person I've ever known to graduate from college as an undergrad and buy a house. He literally bought a house. And a really nice car, and he made some kind of Batman license plate. Batman was popular back then. But anyway, like, right? He's like 22, relatively good looking guy. He's got a great job. He bought a freaking house at the age of 23 because he's never had a bill to pay in his life, and he has all this money and a nice car. And Jeff was the most miserable, depressed, borderline suicidal individual I've known. Like, he hated his life, he hated everything because he hated his job. And if no one's told you yet, you're going to spend a lot of time at your job. So it's probably a good idea that you actually enjoy at least partially. But he's the epitome to me of the foreclosed identity style. Foreclosed means you have not explored at all. But for some reason, you've committed. And I remember sitting in a psych class. Like junior year, and someone was teaching me this very thing. I'm like, oh my God, it's Jeff. And they warned me. They said foreclosed identity styles are related to very low life satisfaction. Like, yep, you're right about that. Can I bring Jeff in to show you? Everyone, this is Jim. Jeff, tell them about your life. Here's a picture of his contract. So a foreclosed identity stuff. The third, you're probably seeing where this is going, if you're smart. The third is something we call a moratorium. Oops. I thought I started to play out. See, now I'm just like screwing myself. More, there we go. Moratorium. Look, three tries it took. Would you believe I was a seventh grade spelling bee champion of Defiance, Ohio? I was. I can say it, I just can't write it. Actually, I can't write and talk at the same time. It's a weakness. So moratorium, it sounds bad. It sounds like I hear the word moratorium and I think like funeral home or something. What do you want to be? A moratorium. Come to my moratorium. But actually, this is where you want to be. In fact, Erickson argued that you can't have a true identity until you spend at least a little bit of time here. And it's probably what you're thinking. It means exploring with no commitment. In a perfect world, this is technically, I'm going to guess most students just see it as like hoops they have to jump through, because Mount Union says you have to jump through them. But idealistically, this is what the integrative core is supposed to make you do, even if you don't want to do it. It's supposed to force you to take a class in chemistry or force you to take a class in psych or soc, when that might not have been on your radar. Like, why the hell am I, and it does happen. There's a number of students who happen to drop in a psych class and they're like, yeah, that was really fun. I like that better than what I'm doing over here. So it does work. Sometimes people switch because they find something they had no idea. But that's what that's all about. And that's where I spent an unrecommended amount of time in. But eventually it happened. The light bulb went off. And I achieved, I said the word out loud. I arrived at what Erickson would call an achieved identity style. And for his argument, this is the only authentic one. It means you've committed only after exploring. So he checks in both boxes. I remember when I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do, but I knew that family development and psychology was it. Like I knew psych, but at Ohio State, it was more or less psych, but I knew which track I was going to go. And I was so excited because I was kind of like a running joke because I was the kid that always switched majors. And trust me, some of them, they're not related at all. You would think, what? But I finally figured it out. Like I knew psych was where it was going to be. I wasn't sure what the job was yet. And I remember coming home and Jim, I was living with Jim at the time, coincidentally on our street called High Street, Columbus, Ohio. But anyway, I went to Jim. I knocked on his door. And he opened the door. And of course, there's a little smoke in the background. It's Jim. He's got his hair. He's like, what's up? And I said, Jim, look, I finally figured it out. And he's like, what'd you figure out? Like, my major, I finally picked one. And he's like, that's awesome. And he parted his hair. He's like, what is it? and I was like, it's psychology. And there was like this awkward pause. And he looked at me and he said, psychology's not even real, man. And then he like slowly went back in his room and shut the door. Like, that was what it was like. It's like, wow, he really is Jesus. But anyway. But I was finally on my way to this. And if you're wondering, just to make it not such a sad story, the end, for 8 years, I couldn't give you the end of the story. But Jeff, about 4 years ago, quit. He literally just up and quit his job because he couldn't take it anymore. And he has money to do stuff. He quit his job and he actually went back to school. And now he's an elementary school teacher. That's what he wanted to do. He finally revealed, like, wow, it was so scary. He could have done this. You could have spent 20 years happier. You wouldn't be as rich, but you'd be a lot happier. But anyway, this making sense? All right, so I clicked one more. We're going to keep going. The other ones we won't spend quite as much time on. So that's you. That's where you're at. How many of you would agree with the fact that it's probably a really good idea to figure out who you are as a person before you get married? Or before you get into like a long-term, not get married, but... All right, well, Erickson agreed with that too, which is why intimacy versus isolation is after identity. He was really the first psychological expert to make that case, like, gosh, before you commit to a long-term relationship, you might want to have a solid sense of identity. Right, you're supposed to go through these progressively. And intimacy versus isolation is exactly what it sounds like. He doesn't mean getting married, by the way. In fact, a lot of people bash Erickson like, oh, I don't need a man. I don't need a ball and chain. I don't need to get married to prove myself. Of course not. No, he's not saying that at all. What he is saying, though, is there's a time in your life when to be, you can agree or not, but he argued to be a full, fully developed person. There's a time in your life when you do need to commit to a long-term relationship with somebody else, or at least some other people, right? In other words, you can't be an isolated, unconnected individual and be fully developed. It's part of growing up. You don't have to get married. Never said that. But that seems like the natural way to resolve it in our society. So intimacy versus isolation. Next up, see if you can, and as we talk about these, gosh, there's a very popular story that's tied to Erickson's theory. Generativity versus stagnation. And by the way, think of where Jason Becker was when all the tragedy happened. He was right here. Right where you're, but he had figured it out. I'm pretty sure he knew without a shadow of a doubt that he wanted to be a rock and roll star. So he had achieved that already. What happened to him, though, is there was this break right here. But generativity versus stagnation, this is where I am. I'm either being generative or stagnant. What the hell does this mean? I think I'm doing okay for a couple reasons. Your parents are probably here. Any ideas?
Being productive.
So by generativity, what he really meant was living a life that's meaningful and purposeful. So you kind of nailed it. Living a life that's meaningful and purposeful. This is a little bit wordy, so I'll keep going. Living a life that's meaningful and purposeful, and in some ways, you're giving back to society. That's where that a lot of people think of generativity. So your job, you feel like you have a purpose. You don't just feel like you wake up every day and go to a factory and push the same button 88 times. You feel like your life is meaningful. You are serving a purpose on this planet, and you've given back to it somehow, or you currently are. Or you're stagnant. You're not. You're just. So how can we figure this one out? And why do I feel like I'm doing okay? Well, there's a couple ways that an adult does this in their life. And the first could be tied all the way back to identity. Your job choice, your career. Some careers are naturally generative in what they do. Teaching is a great example. There you go. Producing something, right? Maybe you're an artist. Are you leaving an impact somehow? People feel fulfilled that way. So does your career have a meaning meaning in life? You know, I met a guy. We ended up having a conversation about Erickson pops up in strange little ways. He came into the therapy room. I mean, this guy was like a Pandora's box of stuff. But he's probably one of the most severely depressed individuals I ever worked with. And one of our first conversations, you always end up talking about why they think, you know, where do you think depression started in your life? And is there anything happening right now that's feeding it, right? And is there anything we can cut off? And he said, well, one of the main things that's feeding it is something I can't cut off because it's my job. I'm like, okay, what the hell's your job? Because how could that be feeding your depression? He's like, he works at Nationwide. He does really, really well. Nationwide is big in Columbus, Nationwide Insurance. Get this. And it's literally the reverse of this. His job at Nationwide Insurance, and he was really good at it, said there's a whole room of them, of this job. His job was very singular. Anytime a claim would come in for anything, it was his job to find the thing in the claim that would get it denied. In other words, it was his job to tell people we're not paying for a damn thing. He would go back to people's histories. He would find things that they did, right? If it was made up or not. It was his job to make sure Nationwide Insurance didn't have to pay anybody anything that they were entitled to. He Can you imagine that being your job? And every time he did it, he got a kickback. So if you save the company, oh, we didn't have to pay out $30,000 for that person's surgery, he would get $300 added to his paycheck. So his job was literally people's nightmares, getting the letter in the mail saying, we're not going to pay for your heart surgery, we're not going to pay for this, we're not going to, right? He knew what was, like, it's eating away at him. He knew every time he did his job successfully, he was hurting someone. Holy shit, no wonder you're, like, walking ball of depression here. Like, but what do you do with that as a therapist? I can't make him quit his job. So anyway, but it's the opposite of that. Finally, if we get on to later adulthood, this doesn't mean like death's door, by the way. I think people read this and they think this is, oh, on your deathbed, you're having an emotional crisis. So this happens really, I mean, think post-career. Let's say someone retires, you got an empty nest, and you're not really, you get to a point where you're just not working anymore. You start entering this emotional crisis. These things aren't like instant things you resolve. They're periods of time. And it is exactly what it sounds like. You either look back on your life and say, all right, that was a life of integrity. I feel like I did everything I wanted to do. Actually, how Dante described how long he wants to live. Well, I want to do the things I want to do, and then I guess that's it. And I'll tell you, I've seen people in the dying mode, I guess you would call it. I've seen people on both ends of this. I've been around people you know are going to pass away relatively soon. And of course, it's difficult because you like them and you'd rather them be on this planet. But they're saying things like, you know what? I'm good. Like, I've done everything. I'm actually really happy. I mean, they don't want to die, but they're okay. And it's weird to be in that position. It's like, all right, well, good job. Well, good for you. But I've also seen it go the opposite way, where people are really just, they're wishing they could hold on because they know, they wish they would have made better choices. They, like, right? So they're thinking, they're more on the other end. So who wants to take a core pathology with you to the afterlife, right? You don't want to do that. Thinking of these last two stages, actually these, is it, any stories come to mind? I always like it when, like, because this is just a theory on paper, and Erickson is like some old dead guy. And you've heard some things that may be connected, emotional baggage, but does this sound like a theme to anything? Let me see, a guy who gets a job, he's doing really well. I guess his first mistake was he didn't get married because he met someone who really liked him, but he decided his job was more important. He doesn't really give back to anybody. He just collects lots of money. Steals from people. I mean, not really steals, but doesn't share anything. Collects a lot. Well, then he gets faced with death. And he starts thinking about his life. There was a ghost that came to him. Three ghosts came to him, actually. And then he got faced with death and got really scared because he realized, does this sound familiar? Christmas Carol? Oh, my gosh, he was inspired by it. You're kidding me. Yep, this is exactly what this story is. You get faced with death, you realize you really lucked this one up big time. And if you could go back, you would change everything. And of course, that's exactly what happens, right? He wakes up and everything's different. Would you believe, this is, I don't care if you believe it or not, when people have near-death experiences, there's actually a common thread. It's almost like Scrooge and A Christmas Carol come to life. It's actually true that a lot of people that are faced with these situations, they look at this stage of their life and they make a lot of changes. Like, they're like, you know what? I don't think I am living a life of purpose or meaning. So it turns out Erickson is on to something with these biopsychosocial critical periods. Oh, it's already up there. So the last little, I think it's the last one. No, there's two more things with Erickson, then we'll, it takes a while to get through Erickson. And this brings us back to Jason Becker. How is he still doing so well at this? Well, it could have something to do with what Erickson called the epigenetic principle. If you ever watched the documentary, and it's really good, called Not Dead Yet, you get to see a glimpse of Jason's childhood and his life. I mean, you probably can assume he has supportive parents if they're willing to build him an eye machine. And like sit there, and I mean, they're the ones that he tells them what to do, and they're the ones that fill in the blanks. I would argue that Jason, like, aced every single one of these. One, two, three, four. Like, he didn't even miss a point. Imagine taking a test and just acing it completely. I don't think he even got a point off on any of them. And according to the epigenetic principle, that should make these following stages easier to accomplish, because the epigenetic principle says this: your success at any given stage of life is tied to your success or your failure at previous stages. So your success, at, so where you're at right now, identity versus confusion. If you aced 1, 2, 3, and 4, I'm going to bet lots of money in Vegas that you're going to do just fine. You may not figure it out yet, but you are. You're going to. But if you picked up a couple core pathologies along the way, I'm not saying you're not going to figure it out. It might just take you a little bit longer because it's going to be a little bit more difficult. Does that make sense? So the epigenetic one. If you ace the previous ones, it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. It just means chances of success are much greater. But if you fail a couple of them, not so much. And the last thing is, there is some deceptive simplicity built into this, because this is a nice laid out life, right? Oh, from birth all the way to age 98. Well, what if when you're 19, you get Lou Gehrig's disease? Wait a second. Suddenly, you're faced with this: ego integrity versus despair, way before you're supposed to. And in fact, you're skipping a couple stages. What if you're 60 and you find out that your spouse has been cheating on you for a decade? What? You're here, and suddenly trust versus mistrust is returning itself to be the theme in your life. So on time, this is what Erickson said about this. If these emotional crises are faced on time, your chances of success are also really good. But they can also be faced off time. And that's where the epigenetic principle becomes even more important. So the deceptive simplicity, you can be revisited, I guess, by emotional crises from the past. Stay on our Scrooge theme. Or you could be visited by spirits of emotional crises of the future that you haven't even, you're not even prepared for yet. But in those moments where you're facing them off time, that's where your success of the previous ones becomes even more important. It's going to be hard, but you'll probably be okay. So the rest of the stuff will be filled in our lecture. Thought I'd show you this.
The paralyzing condition, ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease, cut short the rise of a young guitarist living in Richmond.
But it didn't end his love of music or the inspiration he gives to others. KPIX5's John Ramos has the story.
Lying in a living room in Richmond, you might think a man who can't lift a hand or even speak is helpless, but you don't know Jason Becker.
There's nobody better than that dude. He was on another level.
When people would hear him, they'd turn their head and go, "What the heck was that?"
That was Jason 30 years ago, a teenage guitar prodigy who burst onto the scene, redefining a furious style of music known as fast metal. He helped create a gold album for David Lee Roth, but before he could tour with the band, the crippling cruelty of ALS took that dream away.
That would tend to just have you be frustrated and just lay there and just wait to die.
But Jason had other ideas. His father, Gary, invented a way for his son to communicate using just his eyes, and his friend and music producer, Mike Bemisdurfer, coupled that with technology to create a way for Jason to compose music, one painstaking note at a time. The result is a new album called Triumphant Hearts, which is being considered for a Grammy Award in 5 different categories and features the work of 30 guitarists from some of the biggest bands in the world.
That says to anyone out there, you know, if you're inspired, you have something you want to say, you want to express, ultimately, you get it done, you get it done, really.
We have this picture in our kitchen. I don't know why I'm telling you that, but I just realized watching this, like, oh my God.
Really well, if you've got the talent, inspiration, and the people around you, it can happen.
W-O-Wood B.
With his father translating his eye movements, Jason says, I would be happy if some people's lives were better with my influence. ALS may have taken the guitar from his hands, but he can deliver the music still inside him with just a sideways glance. Oh, and there's this. When famed physicist Stephen Hawking died last year, Jason became the longest living survivor of ALS in the world.
What he means to the world may be bigger than all of the little things that go on in life, and maybe that's the reason that this happened to him.
He cannot move, but he's moved others, and they say their lives are richer for it. In Richmond, John Ramos, KPIX 5.
So he's still around. So be sure to take a look at the interview project. It's highly self-explanatory. So find your older person if you haven't done that yet. 65 and up, although there's leeway there, right? The oldest person I know is 64. That's okay. But the older the better. I think it makes it more interesting. Relative or not, whoever you want to talk to, it's perfectly fine. The questions for you to ask them are there. And there's two parts to this. Really, the first is submitting to a Dropbox. Will you submit to a Dropbox? I guess I'm kind of vague on it. It just says submit a transcript. All that means, this doesn't have to be like word for word, like a script, like I said, then she said. No, it's not a script. So by this, I just mean the questions and then a good comprehensive, what exactly did they say? So it doesn't mean you need to sit there with a clipboard. You'll probably just be able to recall it. So transcript just means here's what we did, here's what we talked about. And if something else came up, because you don't have to just only ask these questions. Right? You can ask more things if you'd like to. Transcript there, and then in the discussion forum, there are some more interesting questions for you to respond just on your own. But it should be maybe some of you actually got it. But anyway, that's it. Unless you want to hang out, I'll be here for a while. This.